Afternoon, everybody. Derek Scott, Scott's Precision Manufacturing, based down in Boston, Lincolnshire. Today, I just want to talk to you about our Trinity 6000 six-row haulm topper, or three-bed haulm topper that we produce. As you can see, tractor mounted, two units on the back, and a single two-row topper on the front. It's a design we've stuck with. We've been building these since 2010, so we're in our 11th, 12th year with a machine now. It's generally been refined, developed, improved pretty much every year. And the reason for that is we like to listen to what the customers have got to say, what improvements they can bring to any design. Everybody's got something to add. And very importantly, horsepower. Tractors are becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. We need to build a machine that's capable of running with the biggest tractors with the most horsepower for the most performance. And it's important to us that we're ahead of the game and not on the backside of it. So a lot of the development over the years has really gone into the transmission and be able to get all that power and energy from the tractor through the transmission and into the rotor for the best and highest performance we can get to do the job it needs to do. I'll walk you around it. There's quite a lot to know, and rather than rush it, I'm going to take you around each little bit of the machine and why it is the way that it is and how it varies compared to the other products on the market. It's not just us, there's a number of manufacturers out there doing a similar thing. But this is quite a high spec machine, and it's worth just going through all of that in detail. We'll start at the front of the tractor, or the front of the machine, and we'll have a walk around the front topper. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about the front topper unit. This is a two row unit, of course. It's a standalone topper in its own right. So we sell a number of these individually. They can be front or rear mounted. And our topper unit is just that bit wider than most of the competition, and certainly wider than what you'd call a traditional two-row topper that's been produced in the 1980s, 90s, 2000s and so on. So those traditional toppers are generally speaking about 1.8 metres or 6 foot chopping width or working width. And we're wider, we're at 2.1. And the reason we go that extra bit of width, there's a little bit of extra cost in the manufacturing, but it's not excessive. But what it does give you is it allows us to run a lot more of the longer flails that sit in the tractor wheelings. And the reason to run the extra flails is all about suction. Now, when we studied air movement and where a topper actually gets its suction from to be able to pick those tops up out of the wheelings, it's all about air movement. It becomes far greater where we have long, flat flails. So compared to a standard topper, we're probably running an extra six of these longer, flat flails. And that moves so much more air and it improves the suction tremendously. So we stick with that, and we stick with this width on all the units. So we're 2.1 on the front, and then both the units on the back are also 2.1. So not only do we get the extra suction, we get a little bit of overlap with the toppers as well from the front overlapping the rear. So we do a double job on it really, and it works very, very well. So just walking you around the topper, we'll start with the input and the transmission side. So we run Walterscheid PTO equipment throughout. We don't ever not. It's the best on the market, without a doubt. So we have a standard 400E lemon tube drive shaft on the front. That runs us into a fairly recently upgraded gearbox. Again, we've looked at horsepower of tractors recently, and everything's on the up. Everything's increasing in power, and we need to be ahead of the game in terms of machinery that can handle whatever we would throw at it. Because at the end of the day, if the tractor's got 250 horsepower, it's just gonna use all of it. So let's make sure this is not the weakest link. Let's make sure the horsepower is, so we get the long life out of the topper. So we've gone for a large gearbox than, we changed that a couple of years ago. Bigger oil capacity, bigger bearings, able to take much more torque through it. We then run across to this shorter, again, a Walterscheid PTO shaft with its overrun clutch, and that feeds to a drive pulley on the side here. So I'll show you this, and I'll show you quite easy it is to get to the working parts. We have a thing here called a bash guard that's just on here to protect the guard and just to push the tops out of the way. And the way we just have to move this away for a start, so we just have an R clip we pull off, we have a pin that just slides up and out of the way. and then that just swings out of the way for maintenance. Guard itself is held on actually with four M12 bolts. We like it to stay on, obviously. I've whipped those out already, so if we just slide that straight off, just to show you the working parts of it. And the front toppers, the transmission is slightly different to the rear. I'll move on to the rear a little bit later on, but this is what we run as standard and have done for the last couple of years. On this particular model, we run the machine on 1000 RPM rating. We only actually run it at 850 as actual working speed. So that gives us, or it works out to be, a 315mm pulley on the drive, a 200 on the driven. And what we've done, one of the biggest upgrades that we did do was go from four drive belts to five, and the difference is massive, quite honestly. Where we really felt we were on the limit trying to put all that horsepower through four belts with reasonable wear and whatnot, the five belt system just takes us way on the other side for the amount of power we can transmit through. You see on here, we run OptiBelt Red Power. It is the best belt on the market, without a doubt. Without a doubt, we've tried everything and everything in between, and these are the ones, and we will stick by these, I'm quite sure. So a good, super strong, high quality German belt. While we're in, here's a couple of things to have a look at. Main one being remote greasing. We have that on the rear toppers as well, which I'll show you around. But again, we don't have to take the guard off. We can just go straight onto the grease nibble, straight into the rotor bearing. The bearing unit beyond the top rotor is a sealed unit. We use double raised Japanese bearings in the through housing here, and maintenance free, no trouble, lasts forever. Remote greasing just makes that life a little bit easier as well. We'll talk a little bit about the rotor and the bearing itself. Again, it's standard front and rear, but we use a UKFX 55mm bearing on here. So what's special about this bearing housing, it's actually a taper lock design. It's not just a run-of-the-mill self-aligning bearing with grub screws in it. This has actually got a taper lock within it. And we really like that for a couple of reasons. One is it's a big, big diameter bearing, so it's got a lot, it'll stand a lot of side load on it. And the other thing is we evenly grip the shaft, so we can have a nice slide fit on with the bearing. And then as we tighten up the nut on the taper lock, it pinches evenly all around the shaft. So we're not just relying on a grub screw to hold that bearing in place. And we get a lovely, lovely tight fit, works really well. When we want to take that bearing off, we can back off the taper lock, give it a tap, it releases, and that bearing should then slide off really quite easily. So we do get on really well with these bearings. They don't tend to migrate. A bit more expensive compared to the standard stuff, but well worth the money for us, and we stand by that. So we'll just move around what else we get on the topper. Quite a lot of features to get through. So your transmission's done, we've got the power to the rotor. Access doors, let's have a look in here then. Inspection hatches, quite handy to have. People do like them on the front toppers especially. So super chunky, non-seizing, heavy duty hinges. We've got these lovely, nicely made over center latches. They are adjustable. I know they can be a bit of a pain in most people's lives. There's not many toppers I go to over the years that they aren't broken. So we've got a really nicely one made here that we had made specially for us. So nice heavy doors, they just fold up and out of the way. What is this to see? Well, we've limited it in some respect because we've got this big old Wearskin. I'm going to talk to you a bit about them on the rear unit so we can see them a lot better. But basically what it exposes the rotor well. We can see what's going on in there. We've got our special little deflectors in there. We've got the Wearskins and so on. We can see better on the rear topper, so we'll go and have a look at that in a moment. But the hatch is quite good, work quite well. Just what you need it to do. What else is going on around the front of the topper? A couple of stands, nothing to talk about them much, but they do what they do. We now put LED lighting on these front toppers. If it's going front mounted, we always put it on. It's a nice little plug and play system. As you can see, we've got these proper waterproof connections. So every part of the loom's replaceable. Super sealed when it was manufactured in the factory. Not by us, but by a specialist company. And that just gives us some work lights when we need them. And then right on the edge here, we've got the side repeaters. We're well aware when you're pulling out of T-junctions on an evening, the first thing that's going to pop out on the road is the topper. Quite a long way from the track to see, as you can appreciate. And that just gives the road users a bit of forewarning. So that's quite an important thing. Depth wheels, I should have a little look at them. So depth wheels, it's another simple thing, really. We manufacture every part of the depth wheel in-house. So we use a much thicker steel section for the outer and the inner part of the depth wheel. They get a rough life, as you'd imagine. There's a big track to be on, a lot of horsepower. You're often sort of dancing in between ruts on the edge of potato fields, and they can be caught, and they often get caught side loaded on. So we do put a lot of strength into these, and that's really quite important. Greasable, big Acme thread within there. Wheels are quite an important thing as well. So we use a much bigger diameter than most. You'll often find, and quite often for price, I think, as much as anything, that you'll often see more of a car size wheel fitted on toppers these days. They're often thought as being a fairly light machine doing a fairly light job, but there's a lot of horsepower behind here. And it's important for us, especially, that wheel's robust enough. So the rim itself is actually used on sort of those dumper trucks. You know, the little articulated dumper truck you see being driven around, JTB, Wingert, they make that sort of thing. This is the same wheel. So it's a super heavy duty pan and rim. We use, it's basically a tractor front tire from a two-wheel drive tractor, 6 inch by 16. So nice and easy rolling because it's a big diameter and really quite narrow. So it finds its way into the bottom of the valley, keeps well away from the side of the rows. Appreciates a bigger diameter, but you get much more of gains than you do negatives with it. So we really like these, and this is something we really do like to stick with and we have good feedback on. So that's important. While we're in this area, A-frames. Now, this is a big area of problem area, if you like, for a lot of front toppers mounted on various makes and models of tractors with front linkage. And what we found is we struggle to find two linkages and offsets and space of any tractor that are the same, you know. So you might find there's very little clearance between the front tire and the wheel of the tractor, and the wheel of the topper. And we'll also look at lift height as well. So some have very, very short arms. Fendt particularly have a very, very short arm. The axle's a lot further forward. So compared to perhaps John Deere. So what that affects is just where this A-frame should be in relation to the topper. So rather than bolt directly to the topper, we have these intermediate plates, this plate here in grey. And what this gives us is three positions for height. So as you can see, the three different hole settings we've got there. So we can mount that A-frame higher or lower, and that'll give us more or less clearance under the topper when it's fully lifted. So we can always find just the right place to suit whichever tractor. We do also do various lengths of these. So when we get a particularly difficult tractor, the Fendt's a typical one. Short arms, they like short arms on the Fendt because it gives it a tremendous amount of lift compared to the longer arms we've got on here. But then we do potentially run with a gap issue between the two wheels. Another issue we get is if we're on very wide beds. So these growers that are running three row systems, for argument's sake, where the wheels are far wider, the sweep of the wheel often interferes with the depth wheel as well. So it makes the whole system very, very flexible for us. It's also very strong, and it just solves all of the problems. Just something we've learned over the years. So it's a nice feature, and it helps everybody out. Running out of things to talk about on the front topper, but the last one, and a good one, it's just nice to have a toolbox. Everybody says the same. They just want somewhere to put a spare belt, a few flails, a few flail bolts in, that sort of thing. So we just put that on there just to make life that just a bit easier. Nicely built topper, built very well. We'll move back onto the rear one. I'll show you a little bit more about what goes on that side. Let's talk about the rear section. A lot going on with this thing. A lot of development and all really worth knowing so you can understand why we've gone to the trouble that we've done. As you can see, she's well built and put a lot of steel into it, but we're mindful of where the weight is. So we're trying to get a nice balance so we're not putting too much steel where we don't want it. But in terms of connecting to the tractor, we're on Cat 3 linkage. The headstock itself is incredibly strong. It would actually be strong enough to take rather than have the two row units on the back, we can put three row units on the back. So we can actually produce a 9-row or an 8-row topper. And we know this headstock is capable of doing that. All right, so two arms, two rams, super powerful, over powerful really for the job in hand. Pivot pins are 50 mil with double grease nipples in them as well, and brass bushed. So everything's safe. Keep greasing them, no problems, last forever. Ram is greased at both ends as well, so that's nice and neat. I'm bringing you to really one of the most important things on this rear unit that most of the manufacturers don't go to the trouble of doing, which I wonder why. But we run a parallelogram system on the rear units. Now, without it, if we were to mount the topper unit directly to the folding A-frame, both these rear topper units are then going to be fixed in their positions. Yes, you can lift one side up by lifting the arm up slightly, but as you imagine, if you're a bit too low to the ground, you want to just take that away from the ground, it comes up in a radius, so you don't really get very good control of it at all. Plus your depth wheels then become off the ground and the thing is flapping like a seagull really. What the parallelogram does though, it allows the unit itself to stay horizontal in terms of parallel to the ground, but that unit will be able to float up and down independently to the unit on the other side. And what that means is we can then control the cutting height individually of each unit on the rear. The front one, you do anyway, it's on its own front linkage. You can manage that easily. But the rear one, if we opt for the hydraulic controlled depth wheels, that can then be adjusted from the cab on the run as you go. So if you've dropped into a sprayer wheel in and suddenly you are cultivating the top of the potato row, you can then just power up those depth wheels at the back, lift this unit up individually and find the optimum cutting height. And it's very stable, very quick and easy to do, and it does exactly what it says on the tin. It's a very stable system, works very, very well. I'll explain a little bit more how it works as well. Obviously with the hydraulic depth wheels on, it's very, very good, and that allows you to change that on the fly. But even without the hydraulics on there, because we put compression springs, which you can just see on here, we put two very heavy duty compression springs under the parallelogram. And what that's doing in essence, it's taking some of the weight off the depth wheels and putting that weight onto the arm itself. And the reason that spring is there then is when that topper's going up and down the undulating valleys and rows, it's easy for that topper to stay, not above the ground obviously, but it's easy for that to ride up and down and maintain its cutting height. Without the springs, you've just got the whole of the weight of the topper on those depth wheels, and that'll want to push through, especially on softer ground, it want to push through into the bottom of the valleys. So taking a bit of the weight off the topper itself through the springs and onto the back of the tractor lets everything move freely. And when you see these running down the field, even when everything looks the same and horizontal and a perfect plant, you'll see these units just moving up and down an inch or two or three. And that just gives us that better, more consistent cutting of the top and controlling the height. So a nice thing, again, brass bushed inside. Don't have to grease these. They're a self-oiling bush and they work really, really well. Okay, so that's the major engineering of it. Talk about transmission on the rear unit. We've covered the front one, what we do there. We go another level again, really, on the rear unit. So rear gearbox, coma, 150 horsepower rated, 1-to-1, 1¾-inch spline shaft gearbox. Quite a bit of information there. Basically what I'm telling you is this is a nicely over-the-top gearbox to do this job. Can honestly say, never had one fail in 12 years. Very, very good gearboxes. Really pleased with those. Won't be changing those anytime soon. Quite a big oil capacity as well. So from the tractor, we use S4, S5, star type PTO shaft, Waltershide, obviously. So big and heavy. Straight into this 1-to-1 gearbox. And then from there, we've got a right and a left opposing PTO shafts. We go a bit further with our PTO shafts than others. You'll find pretty much on any topper, they'll just run 400E or 2400 series lemon tube shafts. couple of years ago, we tried these S4, S5, which is a splined or a star type PTO shaft. What we really like about these is they're so stable and so little or no vibration through them. We find with a lemon tube, when the wing is folded down and the tube's pulled apart, so we've only got a certain amount of overlap, we do get a little tiny bit of vibration, and that sort of accentuates its way through the guards. And after a number of years, that vibration just wears the PTO covers out, puts vibration through the machine. None of that applies with the star type tubing. It's far, far better. Might be a little bit more costly for us, but quite honestly, the reliability and the amount of power we can transmit through just puts us in a better spot. Another little point we do as well these days is that the greasing on the UJ here is direct into the cup of the UJ bearing. So none of this trying to get it in the right spot to get your grease gun through. We can just rotate the cover round to its access point where the hole is, and we can put the grease gun straight onto the bearing. It's a lot less faff, it's a lot easier, and something we really quite like. So that's a nice little thing we've got going on there. Working through the transmission, it's different to the front one, it really is. So we run a 50mm straight shaft between two 45mm bearings, four old flange bearings. You can get straight on the grease nipples of these bearings as well, so they're easy to grease, nice solid shaft all the way through. So yeah, leading on from the cross drive shaft, that big 50mm shaft, we get into the drive belts. Again, we use 5 belts on the rear topper as we do on the front one, but it's a slightly different arrangement, same pulley sizes, but we run a separate idler for a couple of reasons really. The main one being it gives us a bit of extra wrap on the pulleys. As you can see, rather than the belt just going straight across, it forces the belt up and tightens it further into the V's itself. So those 5 belts with the extra compression on there just gives us that bit more pinch onto the pulleys. Gives us a little bit more to rely on in terms of getting that power transmitted through. Remote greasing is on here as well. So the inside bearings on a remote greaser as well as the rotor bearings, so no guards to take off, nice and simple to get done. Hydraulic depth wheels, it is an option on the machine, not everybody goes for it, the majority do if I'll be honest. As I explained with the parallelogram, we've got that ability to raise and lower the cutting height of each rear topper unit, which is quite a unique thing that most manufacturers don't offer. So it's as simple as removing the windy Acme screw on the depth wheel and just replacing it with an hydraulic ram, as simple as that really. It sits on the back there between the outer and the inner leg, and it pushes it down and it lets it back up again. We run a check valve, so as soon as you let go of your spool valve, it locks off, so there's none of that creeping at all. Knowing where your wheels are is important, so as you can see, we have a marker with a rod that shows you the position of that wheel. There's a couple of options of how we actually work these depth wheels, hydraulically, with the check valve as I've described. On this particular machine, the right hand side topper unit has two rams, one on the left, one on the right. The hose is joined together via a T-piece, and we have what we call a 50-50 valve, which allow both rams to stay in sync with each other. That's the idea of that. So they join together at the bottom corner here, and they run straight into the back of your tractor spool. So you need a double acting valve for this side, and basically the same on the left hand side as well. So two double acting services required. In terms of the folding of the machine, again on this one we have a double acting service for the right hand ram and the same for the left. So you may be in a situation where you haven't got 4 spare double acting services, and we appreciate that. So we can give you a little upgrade for that, and it's as simple as we can add in a little diverter valve or two, and what that would mean is we can have a single double acting service into the diverter valve. We'll have a small plastic box with a switch on there, and basically we just switch it from left to right to operate the fold of the A-frame. It's better we don't do it for the hydraulic depth wheels because it's more switches to adjust, to be able to adjust your left and your right. But if you've only got 3 double acting services, the diverter valve works quite neat and easy. You only use it when you fold the machine up for transport. So we've got that little option there for you as well. Moving on to one of the probably most popular attachment really, which is the ridge rollers. Now these are basically rolling along on the topped ridge and just pushing down the soil slightly to cover up any cracks that allow the light in that will give you greening of the potato tubers. So we're not looking to put a lot of pressure on, and it is quite critical that we don't go too much with it or too little with it. But most people prefer a wide, generally a soft tire. The tire we use is 12 inch by 12 inch if you like. It's a low pressure turf tire. We find 15 PSI is exactly where you want to be. Allows them to flex a little bit to allow the mud to peel back off. We did used to run a scraper. This is far better. Scrapers just tend to be trouble. They either bung the tire up from turning or they just build up with tops and so on. So we've gone away from scrapers altogether. So the tire works really well. It's got some give in it, but we need more than that. We need it to be able to move with a bit of spring pressure. So we have this horizontal spring sat over the tire, just putting a bit of pressure on. The whole thing is very adjustable. We can adjust the spring pressure by moving the spring position on the bracket. We've got five holes here we can go to. We'd also move the unit up and down as well. So we've got a series of holes on the back plate, mounting plate here. We've got more adjustment than you're really ever going to want. There will be some situations where perhaps you don't need the tyre. Typically very sandy soils that easily erode down. So to move these up out of the way, we've really thought about how we can make that really quite easy to do and a one man job, because there's a bit of weight in there and sometimes you need three hands if not four hands to do it. So I'll show you quickly how we do it. So we've got a little linchpin in there that holds that pin in place. But really it should just be a one man job. So we just take the weight, slide the little pin out, and then we can just lift that into its new position, put the pin back in. Everything just comes perfectly in line. That's the way we've engineered it. There's no trying to line the holes up. Just lift it up as far as it'll go, pin lines up, straight in. And now that wheel is just nicely out of the way of work. So it's a nice little feature. Nothing very exciting, but it just makes that job a bit easier because life's never easy. Right, so we are at the business end of flail topping, the bit that really matters. And we spend a lot of time and a lot of thought goes into, and probably the bit you don't really see very often, if I'll be honest. So let me walk you through the rotor. For a start, so we built the rotors in-house. Used to buy them in years and years and years ago, but we do everything in-house. We like everything in-house these days, so we know what's going on, keep control of the quality. It's 5.5 inch tube. It's actually pre-balanced. When we buy this tube in, it's actually been honed, straightened, or cold rolled, if you want to call it that. So when it's come through the mill, it's been straightened and straightened and straightened to the point. It's absolutely true, which means we don't have to put the effort into trying to make up for the tube being not perfectly straight and have to weld weights on and all that sort of thing to get it to run true. You're far better solving the problem before you get the problem, if you follow me. So good quality tube is what we use. The lugs themselves, we have a lot longer contact area than most, so we've got quite a long bracket that wraps all the way around the tube, and we get quite a lot of weld on there as well. We don't over-penetrate with the weld either, but the extra length allows us to get a good connection on there. Okay. We do sell the lugs separately, if it ever comes off, which they don't really. Let's talk about the flail itself then. So if you look quite carefully at our flail, you can see we have quite a big radius or quite a steep curve on the end of our flails, and we do that for a very, very good reason. We found quite early on when we was trying different shapes of flails that the bigger the curve, the better air movement that we get, which really relates to the amount of suction that we're creating. So quite a flat flail doesn't move the same volume as air as a curved flail does. So that's really quite an important thing. And the obvious thing really, I suppose, which we know is obvious now, is the wear life of the flail. While it's got a long leading edge on the tip, as it wears back, we still have a leading edge, and it continues until we've worn quite couple of inches literally off the flail before it loses its ability to cut. A quite straight flail with a small bend on the edge soon becomes a flat piece of steel and just knocks the tops down. So we get quite a nice wear life out of what is quite a narrow flail, I suppose, really. So that's a good thing. And one of the really important things I want to talk to you about is flail length. So if we look at these four flails, we've got four different lengths. As you can see, the shortest one will sit basically directly above the row top, which is where it needs to be, and then we go progressively longer. We have found, even when we've experimented with tapered flails, that for the best wear life and to particularly just do the job, it's quite simple and easy just to stick with a square edged flail. Quite honestly, the flails aren't really very close to the side of the rows. They are very close to the top, but generally they don't have to be very close to the side of that ridge. Simplifies the number of flails that you have to keep as a customer and for us. It means we can buy, if we've got less versions of flails, we can buy a bigger quantity, they come cheaper and so on. So it's a sensible way to go about flail manufacturing, and it works very well. So as you can see, this one's set for 72 inch work or 90 centimetre distances between the row tops. So we can have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 full length flails, or the longest ones, in 10 in fact, you've got 5 on one side of the row, 5 on the other. So that's a lot of flails all in that valley bottom, sucking those tops up. And that's what we like. If you'd imagine you've got more of a standard width topper, you won't have these last three, you'll just be relying on two. So you can see why we get so much more suction. So sort of just moving around the topper rod itself, shear plates, interesting one. Been around on straw choppers since 50 years plus, I imagine, but more recently, much more recently on potato toppers. We really like them, really, really like them. When you look at the whole system of flail and spray, which is basically what we're doing, and running ahead of a potato harvester, everything goes better when that haulm is chopped up shorter and finer. We'll chuck a few pictures in here just to show you what I mean by that. But basically, as that flail comes round, we've got a certain distance between the flail itself and the shear plate. And what that does, it prevents the top from going straight around the top of the hood. It holds it back so it falls back and it gets chopped multiple times. As far as we can see, we can't see really any difference in the amount of energy it takes to run with the shear plates in. We've never noticed any difference. So it's almost double chopping for free, really. More recently, we've made these shear plates a little bit lighter. We feel that we maybe made them a bit too thick and heavy. Weight is a constant issue, really, with farm machinery. So we've lightened these up a bit. They're not particularly a wearing item. They seem to last for years and years. So that's what we've done with that. We've hollowed out the big one just to let any mulch fall back so it's not building up inside. And that works really quite well for us. Moving on to deflectors. Really spent a lot of my time getting a deflector to do the best job it can. It's not just a case of putting a wedge in there and expecting everything to drop in the valley bottoms. We've played around with shapes, with style, and ultimately we've got exactly what the right thing for the job. It's a sectional piece, you can buy it in its individual parts, the left, the right, the backing plate, and the little kick plate that we put in. But in essence, it's an adjustable unit. We can set that to whatever row width you're working at. We also do a full width deflector, which I'll also give you a bit of information on. But these, you can see in this topper here, are the individual ones. And if you look at the way they've been designed, they're not a straight arrowhead shape that throw 50% that way and 50% the other way. They're actually straight on the inside and more of an angle on the outside. So as we're going through those two rows, we're trying to put the majority of the chopped haulm in the tractor wheelings and less in the centre valley. Whatever drops in the centre valley these days, especially if you're running centre shear, obviously, is then going to find its way in the harvester. So we're trying to have a bias towards putting more top out the way of the harvester itself and into the tractor wheelings. And this is what this arrangement gives us, and that really does work quite well. Just moving on to the final thing, really, which wraps up the topper, again, overlooked by a lot of manufacturers, is the Wearskin. So this sheet metal rolled piece of steel that we put inside the topper is what I'm talking about. So as you can see on this topper, we've got a section in here, where the long flails are running, a bigger section in the middle and another one in the top there. So we've got two different sizes. They vary depending on the row width. So if you're on 75 centimetre or 30 inch, they're going to be different to if you're on the wider ones. Again, we've developed these a little bit. We've actually just gone in 2021 to a slightly thicker material. We've gone up from 2mm to 3mm. We still can just retain enough flexibility to be able to manhandle them in. But the 3mm now gives us a bit more wear life on them. So that's an important thing. Very little cost in doing a thicker one. Reasons for them. Well, without them, you're going to wear the metal away of your hood. Now, toppers have been built for a number of years. And that was never a problem because toppers were usually used after a desiccant had been sprayed onto the haulm. So if acid had been sprayed on years ago, by the time the topper got to topping them, which was on the front of the tractor with the harvester on the back, there was no greenness left in the, or moisture left in the top. So generally speaking, they smashed up quite easily. There's quite a lot of soil that then stuck to the inside of the topper itself, which gave it protection. Now it's doing a much different job. Perhaps we're in the tater field the same and we're still topping, but we're doing a very, very different job when it's green top. And the difference is there's a far, far bigger volume of top going around. It's absolutely full of moisture, huge amount of moisture content in wet in haulm. And what that does is wash clean the inside of your topper hood. So rather than have that layer or caking, as we used to call it, of dry soil on the inside of your hood, it's now squeaky clean because it's constantly being washed by that tops or that haulm as it's going through. And that just leaves it open to wear. So if you've got abrasive soils, sandier soils perhaps, mixed with that top, it just rubs the steel away. And literally within 1500 acres, you could be wearing through your topper hoods. So it's an easy answer. Let's not cut that out and have to weld a new piece in. For a few quid, let's just put a Wearskin, we call it a Wearskin, but let's just put that rolled piece of sheet steel in there. As you can see, it clips in the back here, sits in a little slot with that bracket, and then it's bolted with these bolts here at the front. So it's relatively easy to put in. Again, these should easily last a whole season, regardless of how much you're doing. So it's probably just a replacement every 1,000 acres plus on a machine like this. So a nice, simple, easy little thing to do, and it just saves you so much time and unnecessary wearing out of parts. So that's probably covered us. Quite a lot of information there, but hopefully it's all been good use to you. And of course, you can always give us a ring and I can explain a bit more. Plenty of videos online. And that is the Trinity 6000 3-bed folding haulm topper. Thank you.